Angelo. When you learn, teach, and when you get, give. Welcome to Conversations with Verdel Jones. I'm your host, Verdel Jones. Being an educator at heart, I'm dedicated to sharing information that is informative, that will inform and enlighten, in the hopes that you learn something that you may not have known. And remember, in the words of Maya Angelou, when you learn, teach, and when you get, give. We have an awesome show planned for you today. You know, you can see some of my past shows on my YouTube channel, which is Deli Teach. So when you go to YouTube, you go in the search, Deli Teach, D-E-L-I-T-E-A-C-H. Please be sure to check out past shows. We've had some great guests in the past, and I want you to check those out. I'm really excited about today's show, though. I would encourage you guys to subscribe to my channel, so when a new video comes up, you'll be able to check it out. So make sure you do that. Also, please follow me on Twitter, and that's Deli Teach as well, D-E-L-I-T-E-A-C-H. And you can also go to my website, verdeljones.com, for more information. We're always looking for sponsors, so if anybody's interested in sponsoring the show so I can continue to bring you this useful information, check out my website and fill out that contact page, and we'll be in touch. And that's verdeljones.com again, so make sure you do that. But tonight, what we're going to be talking about is something that is it's near and dear to my heart. I've been in education for over 20 years, and I like to call myself a college nerd. I'm the director of guidance for a district, and anything college is exciting to me. So today we're going to be talking about college testing. And for those of you who don't know, I am also the author of The Parent Agent. And, you know, I talk about the book all the time. It's tips for parents. It's a timeline for parents and students. And I always like to say that a parent is an agent for their child. It's their responsibility to find out opportunities and set them in the right direction or set them on the right path. And it's the student's job to actually, you know, get it going. So in the book, I talk about college testing. I don't talk about it nearly as in detail as our expert guest is going to talk about it. In chapter 5 of the book, I talk about how colleges actually screen students. You know, they look at their transcript, they look at their GPA, they look at, you know, essays, they look at letters of recommendation. But another thing that's so vital to the process is the college testing. So today we're going to be talking about the college testing, the ACT and SAT, and what that actually, what you need to do to prepare for it. So, you know, the College Board is the company that offers the SAT, and the ACT is the company that offers the ACT, and these exams are needed to apply to college. So our guest today is an expert at helping students navigate this. We had him at our 11th grade, we have an 11th grade junior meeting, and we talk about the college planning process, and he was just an amazing guest. We have our junior conferences right now, and that means that parents and students come and meet with their counselors. And the parents are still talking about his presentation because he gave an awesome presentation about that process. So we are so fortunate to have him here with us today. So we have Mr. Tom Ehlers. He is a graduate of Princeton University and the owner of Method Test Prep. He has a passion for learning, and he's also dedicated to helping students be successful, not only on college entrance exams, but in life, life itself. In addition, he works as an educational consultant with schools across the country to help them improve their test scores. So without further ado, like I said, if you have a college-bound student, Tom Ehlers is really the guy to speak to when you're talking about college testing. So without further ado, thank you, Tom, for joining us.
Yeah, thanks for being here.
I'm so excited to have you here to share the information. I gave a little brief bio, but what I really want to ask is what is Method Test Prep?
Well, Method Test Prep was just me for a while. Both my parents spent their entire careers in education, and at the high school they were at, they said, you know, we have a lot of students not scoring well on the SAT and ACT. You scored well, maybe you could help them out. And within 5 minutes of working with the students, I saw that they had no strategies, no techniques. They didn't know the format of the test. They didn't know the timing of the test. So it was a shame because they were going in with so many disadvantages.
Right.
And within 5 minutes of working with them, I saw that I was having a significant impact on their scores. And at the end of the hour, the student would say, thank you so much. You know, the parent would say, thank you so much. And so I just said to myself, I'm going to do this all day, every day, because it's such a gratifying feeling. So.
Right.
And so you asked what method test prep is.
We
it just sort of grew from there. Once we were having success, we said there has to be a way to get this to more students.
Right.
Nobody thinks it's fair that some kids have a private tutor and other kids have to take the test cold. So most of us believe that every student deserves the same access, the same opportunity. So we created a web-based program. And this way, when a school subscribes to the web-based program, every student at the school has an account and gets the same access. And so with a little bit of motivation, a little bit of discipline, you can learn every strategy, every technique, every trick. I mean, these tests are not rocket science. Mm-hmm.
Right.
If you prepare for them, you will score higher.
Right. And that's one of the things that, you know, as I had mentioned, we had Tom in to speak to our junior parents. And the thing that they walked away with was it's manageable. It's something that they can actually do if they put or if they do these little strategies. And we'll talk about some of them tonight, that they'll be able to raise their scores. And you made it seem like it is achievable. And I think that's what really comes across.
Yeah, you know, it's like everything, right? It has to be broken down into sound bites sometimes, for lack of a better term. And so just one sound bite is each question you get correct on the SAT could be another 10 points on your score.
Right.
And when you share that with a student, it changes their attitude completely, right? Because they're thinking of this, I always joke that the SAT is like the Wizard of Oz, right? You go in, it's just this big curtain. And you don't know what's behind the curtain. Mm-hmm. But if you realize, okay, here's a question, if you get it right, that could be another 10 points on your score.
Absolutely. And you keep building those 10 points up, and before you know it, you've improved your score. Yeah. And I think that's one of the things that, you know, I also loved about your presentation is that you really show the parents and students how they can raise their score with it's not, you know, something that you just say, but it's something that you actually prove out when you're showing them some things that they could do to improve it.
Yeah, I think it's, there are so many myths and rumors about these tests, right? So there's so much bad information out there. And one of the things, everyone is so afraid of the hardest questions.
Mm.
And people don't realize that nobody's getting those questions
right.
So 99% of students are not getting those questions right. So don't focus on those questions.
Mm-hmm.
Focus on acing the easy and medium questions. And if you ace the easy and medium questions, which a lot of students have the potential to do, it's like you said, their anxiety gets in the way.
Yes, absolutely.
Right? So if you just ace the easy and medium ones, you're going to end up with a really nice score.
Mm-hmm. And why is that? You talk about, we always hear test anxiety. I'm not a test taker. I get nervous when I take exams. What should I do? Why are people so stressed out about, I mean, it's a high stake these exams, but why do you think people are so anxious about taking these exams?
You know, misinformation again.
Right.
I mean, one thing I'll say, and I know I'm preaching to the choir here, Verdel, because I know this happens to Verdel every single day, every week, is you talk to a student who took the SAT 3 or 4 years ago who was so nervous, and you ask, how are you doing? And they say, I'm doing great. I'm in an honors college. Mm-hmm. I'm getting, you know, I'm on the honor roll. Mm-hmm. I'm in this program. I have this internship. And this was a student who was 100% convinced they were going to bomb the SAT, and it was going to be the be-all and end-all of their life.
Yeah,
and so the first thing is to say, yes, this is a high-stakes test, but it's not going to determine your future.
Right.
How hard you work in college is going to determine your future. So that's one. And then the second thing is why so much anxiety. It's like everything in life. When you haven't prepared the way you know you should have prepared, you're nervous.
Right.
If you actually prepare, then you can go in and just do your best and say, I'm going to score as best as I can.
Right. That makes a lot of sense. It's that preparation. And we're going to talk about that and what your, you know, what method test prep actually does to help prepare students. One of the things that you hear a lot of, and more colleges are moving toward it, is test optional. So they're test optional, meaning you can still get into that particular college even though it's test optional. Can you kind of speak to that? I know there's an important reason to take these exams, but just speak to those schools that may be test optional and what a student might be missing if they don't take the exams.
Right. Well, what they'll be missing is most schools still require these tests, and even a lot of the colleges are test optional. They would still like to see scores.
Right.
And I mean, my thing is just to give everyone sort of a somewhat of a historical context. I've been doing this now for 18 years.
Right.
For 18 years, people have said, "Oh, you know, the SAT is going away. The ACT is going away." And you know, they're not going away.
No. And they're not.
They're not going away. And the thing is, nobody's a huge fan of students having to take a million tests.
Mm-hmm, right.
But at some point, you have to take a test, and you have to demonstrate that you have the skill and the knowledge to be successful either in college or something post-secondary, right? And
right.
So, I believe that the SAT and ACT, they're not bad tests.
Mm-hmm.
They test kids on reading comprehension,
right,
and grammar and basic math skills and being able to read a math question and understand what the question's asking. So, a lot of the questions on the SAT, these are things you need to know, you know, just to be successful in life.
Right.
So I'd rather see a kid take an SAT or an ACT than take maybe some of the other tests that are out there.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, some states are moving to a system where the ACT is the exit exam.
Exactly.
Or the SAT is the exit exam. And that's nice if that means that they can eliminate the state test.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So we're not adding another test on. We're replacing one test with another. So the bottom line is, listen, I think it's great that some schools are test optional, and I think that students need to explore all of their options.
Right.
But at the end of the day, they're likely going to apply to at least one school where the test is mandatory.
Mm-hmm.
And if you score a little bit better, and I think that's the thing I always get back to, too, is so many parents and students say, you know, my son or daughter is a bad test taker.
Right.
And then I say, but how much has your son or daughter prepared?
Mm-hmm.
And they say, oh, well, they did the question of the day.
Right. That's not preparing.
Yeah. I mean,
it's nice.
So you did 20 questions.
Right.
You know, and this is also the student that will stay up till midnight or 1 a.m. studying for school.
Right.
So the parent will say, I don't get it. My son or my daughter, they do so well in school, but they're not doing well in the SAT or ACT. And I say, well, they're studying 4 hours at night, and then they're not doing anything for the SAT.
Right.
So, in fact, it's not surprising that they do better in school.
Right, because there is a way, and we're going to talk about that, and there is a way that students should prep for these exams. So we're gonna talk about that. But one of the things that I wanted to get into a little bit was the PSAT. We're going to talk primarily about the ACT and SAT, but why should a student take the PSAT? When should they take it? Why is it important? Is it something that they need to do? Because in my district, all of our 11th graders take the PSAT. We made that, you know, we made that decision to help prepare them for the SAT. So what's kind of your take on the PSAT?
The good news is there is a simple answer.
Mm-hmm.
Every student should take the PSAT in 11th grade because it's the most timely way to get a feel for how you're going to do on the SAT and even really the ACT as well, because the two tests are so similar.
Mm-hmm.
So the shame is that starting a long time ago, I was in high school in the 90s, whatever, and I took the PSAT as a 10th grader.
Mm-hmm.
And then, so that's just expanded. And
so
now kids are taking the PSAT in 10th grade, and then parents and families are saying, oh, well, we're not going to take the test in 11th grade.
I took it already.
Yeah, I took it already.
Right.
And and I say, no. The PSAT was designed for the 11th grade year.
Yeah.
So if you were going to skip a year, you should have skipped the 10th grade year.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely take an 11th grade. Now, the shame is it should be used more. The results should be used more, right?
Right.
So students are taking the PSAT in 11th grade, but they're not really looking at the results.
Mm-hmm.
And there's real simple what you should do. You should get your PSAT results. They show you the difficulty level of each question. And you should look for the questions that you got wrong that were labeled easy. And so you should go through the ones that were labeled easy. Often you can figure those out on your own.
Okay.
And then again, each question that you can figure out on your own, that's 10 more points on your score.
Mm-hmm.
For years, people said to me, should I prepare for the PSAT?
Right.
And I always said no.
No.
I said no, mm-hmm. no. And for 10 years, I said no. And then kids were coming to me, or students and parents, and said, oh, my son or daughter is a bad test taker.
Mm-hmm.
They're bad at the PSAT. And I said, hold on. They're not bad at it.
Right.
We made a decision not,
not to prepare.
Not to prepare. So you
right.
you didn't do well on something that you didn't prepare for, right?
Right.
we can improve the score, but you know, it's impossible to change a 16-year-old's mind, right? Try changing a 16-year-old's mind, it doesn't work. So now I've changed my attitude and I say, do a little bit of preparation for the PSAT, because that same student that would have scored, let's say, in 1,000 on the PSAT, they do a little bit of prep. I'm talking about an hour a week, a few weeks. They do an hour, a couple hours prep. Now that student gets an 1,100. Now all of a sudden that student has a completely different attitude, right? Completely different mindset. They think, oh, I got an 1,100 on the PSAT. I could get a 1,200 on the SAT, right? So it's just like I was losing the battle for years. And now I say, and the other thing is, the summer before junior year is an appropriate time to prepare,
to
because a lot of motivated students, kids who want to go to competitive colleges, they're going to be very busy junior year.
Absolutely.
We all get that.
Right.
So it's like once your junior year starts, I mean, it's like a runaway freight train.
Absolutely.
Do some prep over the summer. That's going to benefit you on the PSAT. And then that's just going to carry over, because something that I've heard for again, since I've started doing this 18 years ago, is parents worry that kids are going to forget the things that they learned. They learned from either the tutor or the professor.
Right.
The concepts that we teach, they're not formulas that you're going to forget a week later. They're test-taking strategies, they're concepts, content that you're not going to forget. You're going to use them in school. So you're going to have a chance. So even if you do...
So they're reinforced as you're going through your classes.
Yep. So if you do the prep in the summer, it's not like by November, December, you're going to forget all that
stuff.
You're not. You're going to be using that stuff.
So we have the SAT and ACT. What is the difference between those two exams? I think a lot of people, especially in the Northeast, they think the SAT is king, that you have to take the SAT. But in reality, the ACT is taken more. That may change a little bit in years to come, I'm not sure. But what is the difference between those two exams?
Sure. So one interesting difference is on the SAT, both tests have four sections. But on the SAT, two of the sections are math. So 50% of your score is going to come down to how you performed on the math. On the ACT, also four sections, but only one is math. So for a student who feels more confident in verbal, in English, than they do in math, which a lot of students identify, hey, I'm a stronger English student than I am in math, they may feel more comfortable on the ACT because only 25% of their score is going to come down to their math. So that's a big difference. Another big difference is timing is difficult on both tests. But timing is more difficult on the ACT. So students who haven't practiced for the ACT, they're going to find it very difficult to finish in time. So then parents and students, especially in the Northeast, will say, okay, Tom, so then why would I bother taking the ACT? Well, the questions are a little easier. They're a little bit more straightforward. So a lot of students prefer the ACT, and that's why there's this rumor that the ACT is easier. It's not easier. The questions are a little more straightforward. So kids feel more comfortable because they're getting more questions right. But then they're struggling to finish it. And then also the curve on the ACT is a little tougher. So at the end of the day, not one test is not easier or harder. It's just every college in the country accepts either exam. And they don't favor one. They have a chart where they compare your SAT and your ACT score. So they don't favor one or the other. They don't care which test you give them. They say, give us whichever you did better. So they're giving you two chances to be successful. Yeah, you might as well take advantage of both.
I was going to ask, do you recommend that students take both exams?
100%.
Is there a way that a student can figure out, like through method test prep, for example, we have a lot of Long Islanders watching. Can they how can they compare those two tests before they actually take the real thing?
There are a lot of ways. So on our web-based checklist that many schools subscribe to, most schools here on Long Island, we have a diagnostic for each test. So kids can take a short diagnostic on, and see which one they score better on. We also have full-length exams online. The most authentic way is every single weekend at our two centers, one in Plainview, one in Mineola, we give full-length mock exams. Students come to our centers every Saturday and Sunday, and they take a full-length SAT or they take a full-length ACT. So when a parent calls me for advice, I say, you have your son and daughter come to our center one week, mm. take a practice SAT, and then 2 or 3 weeks later, take a practice ACT.
Right.
Worst case scenario is they just got 8 hours of practice in.
Okay.
Which is probably 8 hours more than they would have gotten in. Mm-hmm. Right. So,
right. right.
At least right. They're doing practice. They're doing work. But really, what's going to happen is we're going to get a sense of, you scored a little better on the SAT, or you scored a little better on the ACT. The truth is, most students will score about the same on both exams.
Yeah.
Most students will score about the same, but I don't like to get into the prediction game mm-hmm. because so many students have surprised me.
Mm.
And again, not to be too long-winded here, but people have to understand that these tests, they're very similar to sporting events where you're at your peak performance, meaning you're it's a very difficult test. Mm-hmm. And so on a certain day, you could be off. And on a certain, I might play in a basketball game twice in a week. One day I shoot 4 for 5 from 3-point range. One day I shoot 1 for 5. Somebody says, Tom, what happened? I said, nothing. I shot the same way. Mm-hmm. Just one day the shots were falling, and the other day the shots weren't falling. That happens on the SAT and ACT. Sometimes you just have one of those great days.
Right.
Some days you didn't get a good night's sleep the night before.
Mm-hmm.
Who knows what? Maybe you fought with your boyfriend or your girlfriend, right?
Right.
It's a million
things. A lot of different things that come into play.
And it can affect your score.
Right.
And because it's such a difficult test. So that's why you don't get into the prediction game. Mm-hmm. You just take each test once. You never know which one you're going to score better on. And colleges will accept either one.
Right. You know, it's interesting that you said you, from your experience, do you normally see students kind of do the same, have the same type of score?
A lot of students. Sure. A lot of students end up with about the same score.
Right. Yeah.
So for those students, you know, somebody could argue, well, then it's a waste to take both tests. But for me, again, at least they're getting more practice.
Right.
I will say that I don't recommend that students take both tests twice. I think that's a little bit redundant, and I think that's a little bit unnecessary.
As far as like a practice.
I meant more almost the real thing.
Oh, in general.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So I like to see a student take a real SAT and a real ACT, because you never know.
Mm-hmm.
Once they've taken each real test once, then they can kind of compare the scores
and
focus on that test moving forward. Typically, you'll take one of the tests a second time, and you might even take it a third time.
Right.
I don't recommend taking one test more than 3 times.
Right. Scores don't usually change after that.
Because it's like a person just throwing a Hail Mary.
Right.
They're just throwing a Hail Mary.
Let's give it a shot.
And they're praying that one, you know. I say, no, let's do a structured plan. Let's study. And then if you do that 3 times, you're probably at, you know, your max.
You're
right. And there's not a benefit to putting in a tremendous amount more time.
Okay. And can you just explain to those watching out there, the scores, because the scores for the ACT and SAT are different, and a lot of people get caught up on what's a good score. So can you explain the scoring for each of those exams and what is a good score?
Sure, yeah, the maximum score on the SAT is a 1600, which is what it used to be.
Right.
Switched to a 2400, now it's back to a 1600. The maximum score on the ACT is a 36. So that gives people an understanding of the best score, the top score. And then the average score on the ACT around the country is about a 21, which surprises people because people think it's higher than that. But that's national average,
about a 21. Yeah.
The SAT, the national average was around a 10-10. Looks like it's going to be a little higher now. The College Board is still like working out the scale. But I share that because, again, people are surprised that it's that low. So when people say, you know, hey, what's a good score?
Right.
You know, a 1200 on the SAT is an excellent score.
It's a great score.
And it's way above average. It's a shame that we have a lot of families, you know, parents or students who they get a 1200 and they're disappointed.
Wow. That's a solid score. That's in the guidance world, we'll say it's a solid score.
And it's going to get you into a lot of universities,
a lot of schools,
colleges. It's going to get you some merit, you know, aid, some scholarship money. So it's a good score. And then the last thing I really should say is, if a person is, you know, really wants to get to the nitty-gritty of what's a good score, look at the colleges that you're interested in and just Google, you know, average SAT scores at that college, and it'll come right up. And then that's a good score if you can score at that level or above, because you know, okay, I'm in the mix to being accepted.
To be accepted. And as far as timing and when to take the SAT and ACT, juniors are, you know, those are the individuals who are taking these exams, but when is a good time for them to actually take them during the school year, or?
Yeah, the nice thing is they offer the SAT 7 times throughout the school year, ACT 6 times. The point is they offer these tests enough times now. Parents are usually surprised by that, because parents say, oh, back when I was in school, they only, you know, 2 or 3 times a year.
Okay.
They offer it enough times that they give some, you know, flexibility, convenience.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that's confusing is certain SATs and ACTs offer a service where the test can be sent back to you.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, that's critical, because if I'm going to invest the time and money to prepare and take an exam, I want to see what I'm doing wrong. It's just, you know, common sense, right? You know, unfortunately, a lot of families are not aware that this service exists.
Right.
So on the SAT, it's called the Question and Answer Service. It's offered on the October SAT, which is not that useful, and the May SAT, which is very useful.
Mm-hmm.
The reason I say not that useful, May is typically when juniors are taking the exam.
Right.
So if you take the SAT in May of your junior year, which is a really smart time to take it, you have to, you, when you're registering, you look for a box that says, I want the question and answer service, and you pay an extra $20.
Mm-hmm.
If a student gets a fee waiver on the exam, then they get a fee waiver on their service.
Oh, really? So okay. It
takes away the financial you know, obstacle, but you check that box, and they send the whole test back to you.
Mm-hmm.
And you can look at the questions you're getting wrong, because these are very repetitive tests.
Right.
They test students on the same things over and over again. So the questions you missed in May, you're going to see very similar questions if you take it again in, let's say, October.
Right, okay.
Or now they're giving the test in August. You could take it August going into your senior year, right?
Mm-hmm.
You're going to see very similar questions. So the way I like to say it to people is, imagine taking a 4-hour exam. You get a score that you're not completely satisfied with. No one tells you what you did wrong.
Right.
And then somebody says, go take that test again.
You have
and that's
no idea.
And that's what's going on.
Right.
And that's why kids are so demoralized by the SAT and ACT. So I know that was a long-winded answer, but for the SAT, May is a good time, May of junior year.
For
and then
junior.
The ACT, they offer that service. On the ACT, they call it the Test Information Release Service.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, to the audience out there, I'm sorry to throw out all these acronyms. People are usually writing down quickly as I'm talking, you know, TIR for short.
Mm-hmm.
It's offered in December, April, and June.
Okay.
So, you know, I always make the joke, I have twins that are in second grade.
Right.
No, I haven't started test preparation
Not
yet.
Not That's yet. Next year.
When they're older, there's no way they're going to take a test other than the ones we just talked about.
Right.
Because if they're going to take the test, I want to know what they're doing.
What the right, exactly. You know, one. I just want to go back a little bit to, you know, the website and method test prep in general. You have a lot of resources on there that are helpful, you know, to parents and students. And one of the things that I wanted to show was the blog. I remember you had showed the blog, so if we can just show that screenshot, a lot of helpful information on there. Can you just, this caught my interest because you talked about how there's a lot of blogs out there, but I felt that this had a lot of great information and resources. If you could just speak to this a little bit.
Sure. When we get the same question from school counselors or from parents, we just write a short article. And so that's why so many parents and so many counselors are finding our blog useful, is that they're the questions that people are asking.
Mm-hmm.
So one we did recently was for a blog with 4 2-minute videos, like your last minute SAT prep.
Right, right.
And it's just a good example of it's human nature. It's the week before your SAT.
Right.
You didn't maybe prepare as much as you should have. Well, you want a short article that has a couple of short videos that at least give you some kind of refresher on this is what you're going to see.
Right.
And you know, but our blog covers anything SAT versus ACT. What's a good score?
Mm-hmm.
So I would encourage people, if you go to methodtestprep.com, you click on the blog and just scroll through.
Right.
You're going to save yourself a lot of time, which obviously we're all trying to do in this day and age. Is you're trying to gather information. Everything you would need to know is in that blog.
Right, absolutely.
And you know, one thing that I like to promise people is these are not written by just any old person.
Mm-hmm.
It's a person who spends all day every day thinking and talking about the SAT and ACT. So people say, wow, this is content that you can't get in too many places.
Right. And the thing is, it's in, like you said, it's in one place. And this is available just for anybody that goes online.
Yeah, anybody can just go to Method Test Prep and you know, what people typically do in the months getting close to the SAT, ACT, they'll go on, they'll look for a couple hours, can print them out.
Mm-hmm.
So
Just going back, because I want to make sure that we get to the differences or the new changes with the SAT. But before we do that, I just wanted to kind of ask if, so you have Method Test Prep, the actual website that people can go on and get resources, but you also provide services to schools throughout Long Island. How can students take advantage of, because there's other things within Method Test Prep that students can use. So how can you explain that a little bit?
Sure, yeah. So first of all, many, many schools around the country and just about every school in Long Island subscribes to Method Test Prep. Okay. And what that means is every student in the school has access to a checklist. We give kids a simple checklist to follow. We ask kids to do 4 15-minute tasks a week. So we're asking students to do 1 hour of work a week. It's every, it's video explanations, audio explanations, audio lessons. Everything we do in a private tutoring session is in the checklist. So if a student does 1 hour of work a week, there are 18 weeks in the checklist, they're gonna go up 110 points on the SAT. We know that. They're gonna go up 3 points on the ACT. Just a matter of doing the work, right? So that's our web-based program that, again, is available to most students on Long Island. The school is providing access. The school is paying for the program. In addition to that, we offer the practice exams. So students on Long Island can come take a practice exam. We also offer classes. So we offer classes at schools around Long Island and also at our centers. And then we do a ton of private tutoring or semi-private tutoring, even small group tutoring. So we try to offer every variety out there because it's obviously not a one size fits all. Every family is going to have a different budget for test prep. Every family is going to have a different, you know, scheduling, etc. So we offer every option, and we try to accommodate every single student.
And that brings up a question that I often get from parents: what should, how should my child prep? Because there's a lot of options, and one parent that after your presentation, they were just confused because there were a lot of options. They don't know if they should take the class that a school might offer within the school day. Should they do something at night? Should they do something online? Should they get a book? Should they get private tutor? How can a family decide what might be the best way to get this prep?
The way I would do it, and again, my little guys aren't too many years away. The way I would do it is I would first take advantage of the web-based program. Because for a lot of people, there's no cost to that. And also, this is just something I'm very passionate about, Verdel, is that kids have to get comfortable learning online. They have to, because in college, if you can learn online, you have a massive advantage. I'm right now taking a couple of online courses, you know, for free. By, you know, these amazing universities. I'm learning a ton. And so I have that advantage that I've gotten comfortable learning online. I can learn at my own pace. I can learn at the times that are good for me. With twin second graders, it's not so easy. So I have this massive advantage. So parents will say to me, well, I don't know if my son or daughter will learn online. I say, well, today's the day that they should, today's the day they should start getting comfortable. So to answer your question, the first thing they should do is take advantage of the web-based program because it's the best value. It's either no cost or it's small cost. Families can pay for an individual subscription. It's $150 for the entire year. If the student needs structure, which listen, a lot of us need structure. Structure helps me as well. Kind of like a personal trainer at the gym. Then I would try a class next because again, a class is such great value. It's at a price point. I mean, we offer one night classes that are only $80. So it's one night, which is all, which is also appealing because we're all busy. So you just come for one night, you come for 3 hours, it's $80, and you get 3 hours of instruction. And by the way, we offer all these classes not only in person, but also online. And so for the family that, you know, doesn't want to travel, I mean, you know, nobody wants to travel any more than they have to. You can go jump right online from home and you can take the same class. So I would try a class next.
So that's like a virtual class. With the actual instructor there.
A live instructor that, that you can see and hear and watch, and then you can chat back and forth. It's pretty awesome to see how much chatter goes on in the online classes. Because these are students who probably wouldn't participate in person. And again, this is just something I think your audience needs to hear and everyone needs to recognize is when a family will say, I want to send my son or my daughter to one of your classes.
Right.
And I say, that's fine. Mm-hmm. But just because they're sitting in the room
right.
doesn't mean they're magically yeah. going to learn things.
Yeah.
Students can stare out the window. Students can zone mm-hmm. out. When a student's online, you know, there's something about it where they sometimes stay more focused mm-hmm. and they can chat with the instructor. And again, that's a student who maybe is shy, maybe has test anxiety. They're not going to raise their hand
right.
in class.
So they can ask, type online and
yeah.
chat back and forth.
Yeah, so again, just to make sure I answer the question, mm-hmm. the class would be my second thing, either online or in person. And then once you have a sense of your strengths and weaknesses,
right.
then maybe you hire us for private tutoring or mm-hmm. semi-private tutoring.
To zero in.
Because mm-hmm. why have a private tutor when you're not even sure right. what mm-hmm. areas you're strong and weak? So
right.
that really, I understand where that parent was coming from because we offer a lot of options. Mm-hmm. But it would be online program, then a class, and then maybe polish with private tutoring.
Okay.
And I mean, every student can do well on these tests. Mm-hmm. It's just a matter of putting in the time.
Putting a little time. Now, so I definitely want to get to two things. The strategies, some things that, quick things that you can let, you know, parents and students, well, it's actually students taking the test, to know that they can do to help their scores. And there's been so many changes to the new SAT, and I know that we should have started with that first because there's you know, mm-hmm. a lot of changes. But basically, you know, just some strategies that students can kind of think about when they're about to take these exams.
Sure. No, and I'm glad you used the word strategy. You know, I don't like when people call it, you know, test-taking tricks.
Mm-hmm.
We're not beating a test.
Right.
So much as students are learning things. For example, exponents.
Mm-hmm.
Exponents are going to be on the SAT or ACT.
Right.
There's no secret, there's no mystery. And there are certain ways that they tend to test kids mm-hmm. on exponents.
Okay.
So you need to spend 20, 30 minutes looking at the ways that they've tested students on exponents historically. Mm-hmm. Well, they're going to test you the same way.
Right.
Right. So a lot, when people talk about strategies, mm-hmm. a lot of the strategies, it's content.
Mm-hmm.
It's concepts that we know you're going to be tested on. Okay. Right. Also, there's, you know, you have to answer every question, mm-hmm. right? So people say, oh, yeah, duh, Tom, we know that. Yeah, but if you look at a student's answer key, when
right.
they get it back, there's tons of answers that they
that
omitted.
Are blank.
That
right.
are blank.
Right.
And the student was told a couple of times to answer every question, but in the heat of the moment, mm-hmm. they forgot or they,
right.
or the proctor said 1 minute left and they were working on a question and then the proctor said, put your pencils down,
yeah.
and they forgot.
Right.
Right. So so that's a strategy right there is when you go into that test, do not leave any questions blank because
mm-hmm.
And people say, hey, wait a second, I thought you got points off for our SAT. Not anymore.
Right. That's now, something new. Right.
That's something new. So that, and then just one more quick one is the both tests, but especially the ACT, love testing students on redundancy or repetition.
Mm-hmm.
All that means
right.
is they put an extra word in the answer choices. You have to just choose the one of the four answer choices that doesn't have a redundant word.
Mm-hmm.
It's so simple. Once you know what that question is, it's so simple mm-hmm. to get that question right.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a good example of, you know, because the tests are predictable, it warrants preparation,
mm-hmm.
right? If the tests weren't predictable, then you wouldn't really need to prepare, right? Because
right.
it's not predictable.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a predictable test,
mm-hmm.
so it makes sense to prepare because you're gonna see redundancy. And if you know you're going to see it, not only are you going to get that question right,
mm-hmm.
you're going to get it right quickly.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You're going to get it right in 10 seconds, and then you're saving time
okay.
for those tricky questions.
The tricky ones, right.
Because you're getting the layups, you're getting those right like that.
Mm-hmm. And when you gave the presentation and you shared that information with our parents, it was, you know, a light bulb moment. Really focusing on those little things can improve their scores drastically if they know enough of those little things.
Yep.
So what are some changes with the SAT?
Just briefly
some changes, because there have been big changes. They went, you know, it was 2400 was the best score. Now it's back to 1600. So what are some other changes with the exam?
Yep. So they took the essay and they
mm-hmm.
made it optional on the SAT, just like the ACT.
Mm-hmm.
And so now the essay is its own separate score.
Right.
So when a student gets, you know, a 1,000 or 1,100, that has nothing to do with the essay. That used to, the essay factored into your score.
Right.
So we can talk about the essay more in a little bit, but the point is, so that's a big change, right?
Right.
Now your verbal score, just comes down to your grammar mm-hmm. and your reading comprehension. Mm-hmm. So right, so that's a big change. The math has gotten a little trickier, some of the questions. So there's some higher level math. Mm-hmm. There are also math questions that are a little bit wordier now that involve graphs, charts. So these are just things not to be scared of, but just to recognize that that's going to be on the test.
So there's a lot of a lot more reading, it seems, on the SAT. They've gotten rid of the
sentence completion questions.
Right, exactly, and the words in context now. When a student has the best strategy to kind of get through those long paragraphs, I mean, some of those writings are very long.
Yeah, the passages are long.
Yep. Right, the passages. Yes. Yeah. So, how can a student go through those passages in the amount of time that they have?
It's a great question, and the answer is you can't. Typically, you can't read the entire passage.
Right.
You're not going to have time to answer all the questions, and B, you're probably going to. Not doze off, but you're probably going to lose your concentration because, you know, let's be honest, the passages are often not the most
exciting
passages. So you have to go in knowing that, mm-hmm. and you have to say to yourself, I'm going to read maybe the first third of the passage, or I'm going to read the first half of it. I'm going to read as much as I can in, let's say, a minute or a minute and a half.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And I'm not going to try to read the whole passage, but I'm going to try to read enough to understand the main idea.
Right, okay.
Because the whole key to both the SAT and ACT reading is understanding the main idea that the mm-hmm. author is getting at. And people say to me, well, yeah, duh, Tom, we've been taught to figure out the main idea since we're in third grade. Yeah, but that's the key to the SAT and ACT.
Right.
And so people get caught up in, they read a sentence on the mm-hmm. passage and they're like, wait, what did I just read?
Right.
And they read it again, and what did I just read? And it happens to all of us.
It happens to all of us.
On the SAT, it doesn't matter.
Right.
That
okay.
one sentence doesn't matter. What matters is the overall passage
mm-hmm.
because the answers, the questions and answers, a lot of them, the wrong answers, will be in direct contrast to the main idea.
Mm.
So they sound plausible.
Right.
The answers sound reasonable. But that's not what the main, in fact, it's like the opposite of the main idea.
You know, and that's I love that you say that because that's really a life skill. You know, I'm thinking about reading a newspaper article and I'm really not reading it every line for line for line, but I'm, you know, pulling out those important points.
Yep.
And that's a skill that students will use always.
And I'm just so glad you said that. And just because I tell kids, you're not preparing just mm-hmm. to get a higher score.
Right.
You need, in college, to be successful in college, you need to be a good reader and a good writer.
Right.
And the only way to become a good reader, a good writer, is to practice it. And so mm-hmm. practicing for the SAT,
definitely.
It's exactly what you're going to do in college. And you're going to get 200 pages to read, which is not even physically possible,
mm-hmm.
you know,
right.
in like 2 days.
Right.
You have to be able to read as much of those 200 pages as possible and pull out the main ideas. And that's
exactly.
That's what a college class is.
Mm-hmm. So it's a life skill, you know, it really is. One of the things that Method Test Prep also does is you guys have study guides that are available for students. So when you go to the website, you can take a look at the study guides as well. I think we have a shot of that, just so people know when they go to the site what they can find. And all of this information is just available to them, even if their school doesn't subscribe or they do. But this is just some more information that's valuable for our students.
And if I could just comment on that very briefly, is that mm-hmm. the study guides are review packets.
Okay.
They're cram packets.
Okay.
Just like when a teacher says, hey, study this. It's going to be on the test
Same
tomorrow.
Kind of thing. Right.
Same kind of thing. So these are invaluable. They're on the website. If the school subscribes, they're in part of the program.
Mm-hmm.
If not,
okay.
you can just go to our homepage and you can download some of the study guides.
And there's another thing. I know you have some type of class that you're going to be offering.
Yep.
If
yep.
you can just tell people about that as well.
Yep. So so next Wednesday night, we are offering a free ACT prep class.
Mm-hmm.
We do these periodically. It's live online, which that in itself is a benefit to students.
Right.
It's just jump online and learn for an hour,
mm-hmm.
hour and a half actually. Just get free ACT prep tips. So that's next Wednesday,
mm-hmm.
22nd, I believe. And again, that's right on our homepage, methodtestprep.com. But if a student says or a parent says, gee, this is great, a free hour of ACT prep,
mm-hmm.
but oh, we're going to be away.
Okay, right, because next week is the break, right.
Or, you know, my daughter, you know, plays softball that night. we record all of our webinars. So then you'll just register and you're going to get a link the next day. Mm-hmm. And you can watch it on demand. Okay. Just like a TV show or movie, watch anytime it's good for you.
Okay. And also I'll tweet that out so people can get that, and I'll put it on my Facebook page as well so people can get connected to that. So now you are in Mineola in Plainview, and so if people want to get in touch with you or they want to know about your services, they can definitely go to your webpage, but you also have offices in two locations. I think we have the locations as well. In Mineola and Plainview.
Yep. Yeah, we're right on Willis Avenue, Mineola, and right on Sunnyside Boulevard in Plainview, just off the LAE in Northern State. So both centers are very easy to get to. Mm-hmm. Anybody who wants more information can just either go to the website. Our phone number is there, obviously. Okay. So they can email us, and we pride ourselves on our school support and our customer
absolutely.
Support. So we'll get right back to
okay.
to folks.
Well, I want to thank Mr. Tom Ehlers for being here. He's an awesome guest, a lot of information. I'm going to put up those links on my website and on my Twitter. I'll tweet it out, and I'll put it on my Facebook page as well. And I just want to thank you for being here. It was a pleasure speaking with you.
Pleasure being here. Thank you.
Thank you.